Welcome, everyone. I am Felicia Day, and this is The Sandman Unlocked, where Netflix Geeked gives you an exclusive look into the shows you love. Today, we're talking about one of the most anticipated comic adaptations of all time, The Sandman. And be warned, there will be many, many spoilers.
The dreams and nightmares no longer seem to recognize their monster. We will remind them.
In this episode of Unlocked, we hear from the creator about finally bringing the Sandman to the screen.
I didn't tell anybody else that it was impossible, but here we are. It is my Sandman. It feels amazing.
You know the Sandman is back.
Deep dive into Dream's journey. Find out what it's like to film an exorcism scene in an actual church. Have the cast weigh in on the shocking finale twists.
I read it and then reread it and and loved it.
And yes, deep dive into that episode. Yeah, you know the one.
There is only the truth.
It's all coming up right now. No, you're not dreaming. The show is about to begin. I could speak endlessly, get it? About what a dream. Okay, I'll stop. This cast is, but how about we just start our conversation? Joining us on stage are Boyd Holbrook as the Corinthian, or as I like to call him, little tiny mouth eyes, Vivienne Acheampong, who plays Lucienne, the ever-lovely librarian of the dreaming world, showrunner and executive producer Allan Heinberg, Jenna Coleman playing trenchcoat fashion icon Joanna Constantine, Vanesu Samunyai, portraying the Vortex herself, Rose Walker, Tom Sturridge as Dream, or Morpheus to his friends, and creator of The Sandman himself, as well as executive producer, Neil Gaiman. The Sandman comic book has had a cult following for years, ever since it debuted 3 decades ago. I'm sorry to reveal that. Neil, you wrote 3,000 pages of Sandman, and wrangling into this piece must have been, I mean, so challenging. How much collaboration did you have with Allan? Did you work back and forth a lot? Were you super involved in trying to make this beautiful multicolored monster into a whole season?
It started with Allan and David Goyer and I having dinner in LA. And 3 days later, we were pitching Sandman to Netflix. And that wasn't very hard. That honestly, that sort of felt like, okay, well, it feels like it would be a TV first season. Some of the biggest decisions felt like they were kind of almost made for us.
Let's go a little deeper with some of our characters. Tom, let's start with you. Sure. In the show, our complicated protagonist Dream's journey starts in this horrible glass prison.
Right.
But his true story begins once he escapes.
Oh my God.
Fred! Fred, look at you! Fred!
Don't move! Stay where you are!
What's he got in his hands? Oi! Open your hands now!
Tom, can you talk about the arc of Dream's complicated relationship with humanity, or can you talk about your multiple collarbones and abs? Your choice, dealer's choice.
The arc of his complicated relationship with humanity, that's a tough question. I think I'd rather talk about my abs. No.
You were naked the whole episode.
Let's talk about that actually, because because I like to talk about myself naked. There was something incredibly frightening.
How do you introduce your protagonist when he doesn't speak and he doesn't move? And it was incredibly important to me to somehow articulate this otherworldliness, this inhumanity, this quality of endless. And and from the source material, for sure, the images that were created and have been created of him throughout the 3,000 pages. And also from this, this idea of a creature. I did work very hard, hopefully, to create an image that would tell an audience that story with no words, to create a body that wasn't human, that wasn't kind of like, I don't know, like a muscly guy. Do you know what I mean? Like an Abercrombie and Fitch, like, dream.
I'm sure people are having dreams about you, Tom. Don't worry, the fandom is
rabid. No, but just someone who's like, who has nothing, who's just like bone and sinew and like has put every single ounce of his energy into holding the universe's dreams together and therefore has burnt it all away. So that was my thought behind it.
So that's why you are in shape. What did you have to do for
There's
that?
There's no visual trickery. That is Tom's body.
What's so frustrating?
Are you kidding? I would never work that hard for anything, man.
You think when you like enter the DC universe, they go like, okay. There's a room, it's on the back lot, there's a samurai there with a machine.
Yeah.
It takes 20 minutes a day, and he tells you the secrets of how to become
a superhero.
Yeah. And unfortunately, all they do is they go, you know those weights you've been lifting? And you go, yeah, okay, so now you're gonna lift the biggest ones. And you go, you know you do it like 10 times, now you're gonna do it 1,000 times every day. For 5 hours.
I mean, Boyd, what about your glasses or your tiny little mouth eyes? Did you have those contacts in the whole time? How did that work?
How did I do that? well, it's a trick that I'll never tell. And the reveal was huge.
Yeah.
About, you know, those glasses coming off. You were very particular about that, Neil, and we finally found that. I mean, and thank God to all the other actors in the world who dramatically took their sunglasses off in the audition. somehow got by.
Jenna, how was your trench coat power? Did you feel more powerful in it? You were such a presence as this character. Really, I want to see a spin. I mean, I just want to see more of your powerhouseness.
Yes.
How did that feel? Like, was that part of your process?
Well, we actually went through quite a few iterations. I mean, I think I had we had something like 10, 12 costume fittings because we almost did a version, like at some point I remember we had like braces. Mm-hmm. We like went down like a very, a bit more tomboy, kind of a bit more masculine route. And then we was very much like wanting to play on the kind of, you know, she's now, you know, necromancer to the royal family and she's kind of, you know, upgraded and very sleek and sharp. I mean, I had a lot of fun with the collar. And also, I got really overexcited about having a crucifix in my boot, and I was literally trying to get it in like every shot. I was like, can I whip it out? Yeah, like all the time. Yeah.
Was there anything specific that you kind of hooked into for your character, Tom?
I'm an obsessive Sandman fan, and what I wanted to do, very seriously, was realize the images that I'd seen from the comic on top of my body. I wanted my skin to be as pale as the paper you pull out of a printer, and I wanted my hair to be wild, and I wanted my eyes to be as dark as a night. And we did that. And I think Alan and Neil will agree with me, is I looked ridiculous. I didn't look like an organic being. I would have rocked cosplay. I would have smashed it at Comic-Con. We just started to learn from that mistake. And it got to a moment, I think, where I kind of looked in the mirror and with everyone together, and people sort of went, Tom's kind of sickly pale anyway. and his hair is pretty dark. And if you look deeply into his eyes, you can see the cosmos. So,
wow, Tom.
We're good.
There was one little thing I'd like to drop that I love particularly about the season, Despair's Crocs.
Ah, yes.
That was like,
I'll tell
kiss.
Sarah Arthur you said that, our costume designer.
Crocs are despair.
I mean, well, God bless.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Alan, can you talk us through the casting process for the show and the changes you made from the source material for the characters?
Yes. We were very lucky in that because it's Neil Gaiman's The Sandman, many, many actors really wanted to take part. And my favorite way to work has always been to write with the actor in mind. So it was a huge relief for me as a writer, once we had this cast assembled, to be able to hear these actors' voices while working on these scripts. And then once we all got together, working with them on the scripts. So a lot of it got written once these performers had been cast. Boyd especially, the Corinthian, I think, changed quite a bit. Once Boyd sort of stepped into the role, Neil and I decided, you know what, we're gonna embrace everything that Boyd is, and really wrote to our understanding of Boyd and his gifts. And there was a version of that with Viv and with everybody in the cast. So it was a pleasure.
It's incredible. Vivian, can you talk a little bit about your character, Librarian of the Dreaming World? Did you study the character in bringing your version to life?
I think the source material is so rich, you're starting from a really amazing place anyway. And then Allan has written it so well and so fantastically. So you've already got a really amazing foundation. And then I just built on it with what I thought I could bring to it. But as Alan's just said, it was so collaborative and open. So it felt really good and organic.
Your character, Lucienne, holds down the fort, or should I say the palace, while Dream is away, when everyone pretty much else fled. Why do you think your character stayed behind?
She hoped he would come back. I feel like she knew somewhere deep down inside that he would come back, mm-hmm. and he wouldn't just leave like that. And there's a loyalty there, so she would never have fled.
Why do you think he deserves that loyalty, though?
Oh, that is a fantastic question. Because they do have this bond. You know, even though he is this complex and can be a bit mean to her, I feel like she knows him and there's something special there, and she has such a deep care for him that she only wants the best for him, really. So I think, yeah.
Yeah, it's a beautiful relationship between you and an entity that's not quite human, but
yeah.
That humanity brings you together in the end, which is like one of my favorite scenes.
Definitely, and it was such a lovely scene to film, actually, because we had this connection when sometimes it's been a bit, you know, removed, but yeah, it was.
Yeah, let's take a look.
What made you change your mind about me, sir?
I had no right returning here after over a century expecting everything to be just as I left it. Lucienne tried to tell me that. So did you. But now I'm listening. Or trying to. New dreams. New nightmares. A new age.
Thank you, sir.
Vivian, can you talk about how the relationship with you and Dream got to this point? It's so beautiful. The internal pride in it's just so delightful to see.
Sorry, what was the question? I was thinking about that.
You were so drawn. You were so involved.
Yeah.
How did you and Dream's relationship get to this point, and how do you feel going forward?
I think that there's a new trust that has been built. She was holding things down, you know, whilst he was away. And I think he was a bit reluctant to give her that when he returns. So I think that there's a new trust there. I think their bond is stronger. I think they're going to start working together more. I'm excited for how they, you know, develop their relationship.
I know fans are too. We have a fan question for Tom and Neil from @OneIroCritica on Instagram. Why are pride and melancholy such core parts of Dream?
Oh, because that was the way I wrote him.
Okay, answer question.
I mean, I loved the idea of writing somebody initially who was just, in so many ways, a disaster, and in so many ways, so important, doing so much right, so responsible, and absolutely unable to get out of his own way. And that, for me, was the joy of this character?
What's the greatest weapon for battling melancholy? It's probably love. And it's the love of your partner or your family or your friends or bearing witness to a stranger. And Dream doesn't have those opportunities. He has to deny himself love because his responsibilities are so great that if he fails at them, the universe falls apart. And that can breed a bit of melancholy.
Yeah. Well, in episode 6, it seems to be a turning point for your character and his journeys. Can you talk about his interaction with death and how that affects his meeting with Robert, which I just love that episode because you're going through so many centuries. Can you talk about the relationship with death?
I think the extraordinary thing that death shows him is the complexity of humanity. She asks him to bear witness to people in the last moment of their lives, and that something happens when you look closely at something, you begin to understand it. And I think that understanding are the first steps towards love. And I think when he has that that pivotal transition, he thinks to himself, if I can feel this about these people after such a short space of time, what do I feel about a man who I've spent 600 years with? And so he returns to him. And in the episode, you'll find out.
That's very beautiful. You're emo inside and out, aren't you?
Yep.
Neil, can you talk a little bit about the theories that Dream is a reflection of you as a person? I mean, you both have great hair, but is there any other connections there?
Pride and melancholy.
Exactly.
You do pride and melancholy very well. Pride and melancholy are us. It's weird because people say to me, you know, obviously you created this character to look like you. And I have to sort of point to photos of me in 1988 and what Dream looked like when he started and say, look, we were nothing at all alike. But it's like people and their dogs who grow to look alike over time. You know, we just sort
like
of
Pekingese.
We kind of did the that. There were, but I mean, when you're a writer, you're definitely going and finding the bits of you that are characters. But having said that, the people who go, oh, you are Dream, it's like, well, yeah, but I'm also the Corinthian, and I'm also Cain and Abel, and I'm also, you know, I'm all of them. I'm Matthew the Raven, and I'm Merv Pumpkinhead. So you go and find the bits of yourself that you can extract and use and burnish and recreate. That's how you make characters up. So obviously there's lots of me in Morpheus, but there's lots of me in all of them.
Throughout his journey to retrieve his tools, Dream encounters friend and foe alike. Initially, he's not so sure about a certain Joanna Constantine. Let's take a look.
I wonder where your home could be.
I presume it is in hell with the demon to whom it was traded.
Yes, but which demon? Give me the princess and I'll tell you.
Exi, ego, agaleo.
Wait!
Fine, fine. I'll tell you where your helm is. Just don't send me back.
Constantine!
In the gentium, agaleo.
I command you!
Visitat qua sumus domine.
Dream of the Endless commands you.
Run along and fuck off back to hell.
You have no idea what you have done.
I do that. I've just tripled my fee.
You are such a badass.
Such a badass.
It really is amazing. How was it like? What was it like to perform an exorcism in the church? Was that awkward?
It was fun. it was. I mean, yeah, that setting was amazing. With we were down in Greenwich. So the set was really, really, really incredible. But yeah, it was fun. Never done an exorcism before.
Yeah. Or Latin. Was that interesting to learn all that Latin?
Yeah. Yeah. It was. I think it was bang on.
Clearly worked.
It clearly worked. It sounded authentic with me.
The demon's not there anymore.
Exactly. Allan, with such a rich world of lore, how did you develop Jenna's character, which appears to be a combination of both John and Joanna Constantine from the comics?
Well, Neil and I had both felt that John Constantine had been fairly well represented in other media. You know, he was on the CW, there's been a movie. And the minute I heard you know, Neil's pitch about making John Joanna, I thought about Jenna. We both thought about Jenna and Jenna's voice. And that went a long way just in terms of my conception of who she was. And I wanted a fairly upmarket, I wanted a different clientele. I wanted a different spin on the trench coat. I just wanted to see something that was familiar and evoked everything I love about John Constantine. But let's just see it in a new environment. Let's see what happens if, I think their souls are very similar. And the backstory, I mean, we got to do the Newcastle backstory for the first time in, I don't think that was in the Keanu Reeves movie, but that was very important to us to do, you know, as faithful a version of the Newcastle story as we could. But a lot of it was steered just the way that I had Jenna's voice in my head and what I, and we just had a lot of fun, yeah. I think, on all fronts.
Jenna, it is an understatement to say that your and Rachel's love story is heartbreaking. Can you talk about the juxtaposition of Joanna's tough exterior with her obviously problems with human relationships?
Yeah, I think that's the like such the appeal of the character. It's everything about, you know, self-protection and having a big heart and having to like shut everybody out and using it to completely deflect and such kind of a lonely character as well, and using humor in that way as well to kind of defense mechanism all of the time.
Our next character we get to focus on is a literal nightmare. Yes, we are talking the Corinthian.
Best to be what you made me.
No. You've done your worst, which was in so many ways what I had hoped. You were my masterpiece.
A dark mirror made to reflect everything humanity will not confront.
That's what I am. That's what I've done.
No. Look at you. Walking this earth for over a century, infecting others with your joy of death. But what have you given them? What have you wrought? Nothing. Just something else for people to be afraid of. That is all.
So what now? You send me back into their dreams? Because I won't go willingly.
A knife against a dream.
Oh, you don't think dreams can die? Let's find out.
Enough.
Boyd, can you talk a little bit about making this murderer actually a little bit more layered than you'd expect?
Yeah, I think that, you know, his main motivation has been to terrify people in their dreams, and that's been his job. But he doesn't have that job anymore. So he's really like a person who's been locked in jail for a long time and maybe convicted wrongly, and you can now live your life how you would like to live it. He's a person who's really drawing out everything, all the satisfaction that he can get out of life as quickly as he can, because there's a ticking clock on his life, and he knows that. And again, not a person who's overtly physically intimidating, but more of a person that you would welcome to dinner, and he would eat you for dessert.
Yeah, there's a quiet menace to him that is really intimidating. Was there something specific that you took inspiration from, or was that something you worked on with Allan and Neil?
Well, I think that's something that we just found out as you go along. Yeah. You can read the scripts and interpret it as much as you can, but then there's like 7, 8, 9, 10 that you're not aware of when you're starting this. I found him to be more Hannibal Lecter than this really outrageous physical embodiment of movement. He was more still and precise and exact and very cunning and very methodical and very, very intelligent.
Yeah.
Very.
That made it more creepy, actually. Neil, can you give us some insight into the speech that the Corinthian gives to the Zero Convention? I mean, it's not every day you hear murderers referred to as entrepreneurs and American dreamers. It's really creepy again.
Well, I think every convention with a guest of honor needs a guest of honor speech.
That's
you
right.
Need a keynote speech. Yeah. I liked that on the one hand, it is both an inspirational speech and a kind of a parody of all of the inspirational speeches you'll ever hear, yeah, guests of honor give. But we got to do something more with it here, because actually his keynote speech is also kind of the connection between Rose Walker, between the Vortex and all of the serial killers. And it is empowering him. And it's also, you know, using Rose to try and create a reality in which this really is true. They aren't just pathetic losers who kill people, as Morpheus says. They're actually, you know, in their minds, they are American dreamers, entrepreneurs in an expanding field.
It really is. It's clear that you two have been to a lot of cons. I'll just tell you that.
I remember being there on the day when we shot it and standing behind camera watching Boyd give it and just thinking, this is the most charismatic performance I've ever seen in my life.
It really is.
Okay, I will go outside and kill for this man right now.
He's very crushable as a murderer.
As a young woman who just wants to bring her family back together, Rose Walker unwittingly becomes a force as the Vortex, threatening both the dreaming and the waking worlds. Don't you know it? I got a clip for you.
The dreaming is yours. Is that what he told you?
He told me you were going to kill me.
Did he tell you why? When a Vortex brings down the walls between dreams, she creates a single, volatile dream that will collapse in upon itself and take the waking world with it. Your world, everything, and everyone will die.
Don't believe him, Rosie.
It's happened before. I failed in my duty. An entire universe was lost.
He can't kill you if you kill him first.
Killing me may save your life, but it will not save the lives of those you love.
I'm trying to keep you alive here.
I'm trying to keep your world alive.
You have to choose one of us, Rose.
Enough. If I'm as powerful as you say I am, then I will find my own way. In the meantime, the walls go back up. Because I'm not dreaming anymore. Thanks to you two, I'm wide awake.
Rose was a victim most of her life, and yet toward the end of the season, she finds she has this incredible power. Can you talk about her journey?
In the beginning, when we first find her, you know, she's lost so much and she just keeps on losing things, you know. She loses her brother, she doesn't have a good relationship with her father, and then her father also dies. And then her mother, the last person that she had, you know, with her, and probably just her pillar, she dies as well. And she just, you know, been in this constant state of loss. I guess that, you know, takes a toll on the psyche and the confidence you have and the kind of victimhood you can fall into. And throughout the show, she meets so many people and she has this renewed sense of hope, from Unity to Hal and everyone in that house. And finally seeing Jed in the first dream, in the first dream she sees him in, being able to grasp at something that she's been yearning for so long, and expanding that hunger within her to have what she wants. And with the encouragement and the confidence that she's given by the people who are vying so much for her, I think she got to a place where she was like, she was ready to fight for it, and she was ready to keep it at all costs when she finally got a taste of what she wanted in her life. And she finally got the confidence to take that in the end.
That arc is so beautifully performed. And it is a sense of she's a loner and then she finds all this family. Allan, can you talk a little bit about Dream, or Rose being a foil for Dream? It shows a different aspect of humanity in their relationship and it really humanizes him. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's an interestingly dark moment for Dream, because he knows there's a threat out there and he lets the threat stay out there. And he's actually using Rose for the first half of that arc. It's pretty dark. And Lucien's onto him about it and gives him a hard time about it. But he wants the other missing arcana to be gathered by Rose. And so he essentially uses her. And then she wakes him up out of this sort of self-absorbed, I have to make my realm a certain way. And he, in the course of it, he also finds out he's been manipulated by his sibling. So he has this astonishing realization through Rose that he's been blind this entire time, that he was so committed to doing his job and doing his job well that he didn't see the truth right in front of him, that he didn't see he was being played. Mm. And it's humbling to a certain degree, but I think it also wakes him up. So he unleashes Rose's power to dream her own dream, to self-actualize, to become a writer. He gives her that gift, and she basically saves his life in that moment by, you know, her bond with Unity. Unity comes to the rescue, and Dream is rescued from this trap that Desire has been set. So they save each other in a great way.
Fans of the comics might have seen that twist coming at the end, but it still managed to be quite a shock.
I'm so sorry.
No, don't be.
I'm not. I was meant to have died a long time ago, Rose. But if I had, I would never have met my golden-eyed man. And we would never have had our beautiful baby girl, and you would not have been born.
Wait. The father of your child had golden eyes.
I've never seen anything like them.
I have.
Ooh. Mm, how, for the cast, when you read that reveal in the script, what did you think? Vanesu?
Yeah, I first found out with the comic, in the comic, and I mean, from a personal point of view, I was just like, okay, that's pretty cool. Yeah. and I get all these powers. Exactly.
I read it and then reread it and I was like, what? And then read it again. I was like, what? And loved it. And then again, was like, oh my God, this is so dark. And loved it. Yeah. So yeah, it's so amazing. It's so cool.
Jenna and Boyd, I hope I didn't just spoil you with that clip, but I guess.
Total spoiler, I'm in shock, yeah. I can't speak.
All right.
We didn't get the scripts that we participated.
I'm so sorry.
They ruined the series for me.
Neil, talk about designing this twist and the larger impact it has on the politics of the Endless.
The politics of the Endless are complex. The power plays between the Endless and this family are kind of complicated, but the sort of simplicity of it is that one of the things that the Endless really must never do is spill family blood. They cannot kill their own bloodline, because if they can, then you get the kindly ones who we've met so far in various incarnations, essentially as the Fates, several times. But you don't want to get them mad. Mm-hmm. And if you get them mad, then you're dealing with the kindly ones. So what is very important for Dream is not to spill family blood. And of course, had he killed Rose, he would unwittingly have done so, even though he would have dealt with the Vortex. So we had to build a kind of a complicated thing there to set that all up. And of course, it also, in the sort of Chekhov's gun kind of thing, brings several guns now onto the table that the overall, the big mega arc of Sandman is going to see either fired or not fired as things go on.
Nice. Tom, how do you think this ending and the twist affect Dream's character arc and relationship with humanity? Do you think he's a changed being now?
I think he's certainly a changed being. I think that, you know, I think one of the things about the twist is it does also bring it back to his position in the Endless. I mean, I think the first thing he's thinking when he finds out that Unity's lover had golden eyes is, how could it be that my sister is prepared, because of a feud within our family, to jeopardize the universe, to jeopardize the world of humanity? How far is she prepared to, or are they prepared to go?
It's a pretty good setup. Fan question for Neil from Ariel Man on Instagram. Why does Desire hate Morpheus?
If you read a book called Endless Nights, you will read a story called The Heart of a Star, which takes place fairly soon after the creation of the universe, and in which it occurs so long ago that Desire and Dream were on the very best of terms. Mm-hmm. But I think on a sort of a mega level, they are very similar in ways that they cannot, neither of them can perceive.
Yeah.
And I think that you need dreams to keep going as a human being. And I think you need desires and desire as a way to keep going as a human being. But they too can kind of get in each other's way.
Yeah. To the cast, which character did you not get time on screen with that you really wished that you could have a scene with in the show? Not, we're not trying to plant it in Alan's mind, but maybe. Boyd, do you want to say?
I just got one scene with you, and I felt a little gypped.
All right, so more Lucien and Corinthian. What about Jenna?
I feel like this would have been an interesting dynamic.
Yeah, we would have got down.
Yeah. I want to see these sunglasses.
I know there was someone, but I can't remember.
Who? Despair.
I think, yes. There was a scene that was written, but then we didn't shoot it with Desire, and I think that would have been fun.
Yeah, it smells like that might happen. I don't know. Tom?
Despair.
Yeah. Yeah, Crocs and RS. Okay, we talked about the ending, but can we talk a little bit about the episode that I really couldn't sleep after watching? I have two words. The diner, it was, yeah, I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one saying it was traumatic to watch. The comic on which this episode was based, 24 Hours, has been known as one of the most terrifying comics in the DC history, and you wrote it in 1989, Neil, so thank you for that. You know what I'm gonna do now? I'm gonna show you a clip.
Where there is no good or bad, there is only the truth.
Okay, yeah, I couldn't sleep after that. Most of you weren't even in this episode. It's a horror show.
Tom is only in it at the end after it's all happened. He gets to.
I watched that whole clip.
Whole clip, and now you know exactly what's going on.
I mean, what's nice? Let me just say on the diner, what kept us going? What kept me going when I wrote that in Sandman in the beginning, and what I feel like and keeps everything moving is the knowledge that you're going to be getting to the sound of her wings. Mm. You're going to be getting to episode, yes, that's episode 5. And it's really hard, and it's awful, and it's implacable, and it's heartbreaking, and it's monstrous. But if you get through it on the other side, you've got death, and you've got Hobgadling, and you have our most heartwarming, our gentlest, our kindest, our most healing episode is there waiting for you. And I think that's kind of important. Mm-hmm. I hope that the people who attempted to stop watching Sandman after the diner get talked into watching the next one by their friends, because it kind of makes it okay again.
No, it is superb. Kind of, it really is. And I mean, it's just a horror movie. So every episode this season really feels like its own movie. It's like a period piece, a Shakespearean play. There's a slasher film here, sci-fi, fantasy, comedy, sometimes all in one episode. Alan, how do you approach a show that spans so many genres to make it a cohesive whole?
Well, I think a lot of it, again, it goes back to the source material. We're telling, yes, the show has sort of anthological shapes to it, in that you are going through different time periods into different worlds and different realms, but it's such an intimate piece, and it's so much about the emotional relationships between Dream and the people in his realm and Dream and the people in the waking world, and the effect that he has on the waking world and the effect that the waking world has on him, that as long as we stayed focused to that through line, then I think we could have gone anywhere and done anything. We're telling the same very, I think, very intimate emotional story the whole time. And I think that's also what goes to making Sandman as universally beloved as it is 34 years later, is that it's deeply, deeply human and emotional and intimate.
Yeah. We actually have a fan question for you, Neil, from Ash W. Hurst on Twitter. Which issue from the comics was the most difficult to adapt?
I think, honestly, the first issue, actually, the opening, was the hardest. And it was the one that, even once we'd written the script, the script for that was written by me and David and Allan all writing together. But it was probably the one that we've done the most work on even after it was shot.
Oh.
Because it is a story that covers 105 years that we have to do an awful lot in, and that you, your main character is on screen, but mostly he's trapped in a globe, stark naked, unable to say a word, or refusing to say a word. So there's a lot of heavy lifting you need to do in an episode like that.
Yeah, well, it's a perfect pilot. When you look back on the season, it must have been so difficult to shoot, especially during COVID. What are you most proud of? I'm going to ask you guys.
I'm most proud that we did it at all. I mean, that we made it happen. Shooting during COVID, and especially shooting during that first 18 months of COVID, was a lot like dancing on a wall while people throw cans at you. And that the cans barely knocked us off the wall.
Mm-hmm.
That we, you know, we had to, we were delayed for many months and we had to stop for a bit. But we kept going and we kept dancing and we made this amazing show, and I'm so incredibly proud of all of the people who endured all of the COVID protocols and who kept going and made the show.
Yeah. Is this your Sandman, Neil?
Yeah, it is. And I look at it on the screen and I know how impossible it was to ever get here. And I suspect that the only reason we got here is I didn't tell anybody else that it was impossible to have got here. And so they didn't know, so they all went along with it. But here we are, it is my Sandman.
You did it. And that is it for our show. Thank you for joining me and the incredible cast and creators of The Sandman. I feel very privileged. As for updates on all new Netflix news that's fit to dream about, follow at Netflix Geeked. And goodbye. Bye, thank you so much. Bye.